put like this seed in my heart of a love for missions. And even after I came back, I felt like he started drawing me into more international missions, and he was speaking long-term international missions over my life. And that was, I was about 18, 19, 20 when I started feeling that. And I'm 36 now, just to give you guys an idea of the time frame. So for about 10 years, I worked and I went to school in like the secular world because I felt like God was saying, this is my dream for you, but it's not for yet. So he had me wait and he had me work other jobs, and he worked in my character a lot. And you know, I spent a lot of time with Jesus, and he just poured into my heart and spoke identity into me and things like that. And then when I was, I think I was 31 in 2018, was when I had just finished, well, I had gone to IHOP U for 6 months. I finished, worked for a few years. And then in 2018, he led me to do a DTS with YWAM, with Youth with a Mission. And they have a discipleship training school. They have them all over. But I did a 6-month discipleship training school in Kansas City from 2018 to 2019. And it really like impacted my life. And Jesus changed my heart. And we went to the Philippines, and I loved being in the Philippines. I loved the people there. And during that time was when I felt like God was like, you're about to step into full-time missions now. And he said, go home for about a year and work part-time and spend time with your family, raise money, and then you'll do more missions. And I didn't know exactly what that would look like. But when I was at home, he was reminding me about David's tent. And I don't know if any of you are familiar with it, but I didn't know a lot about it. I had come across it kind of accidentally. And I had never been there. I had visited Washington, D.C. before, but I had never visited David's tent. But I felt like God was saying David's tent, and I went on their website, and just through a few confirmations he gave me, and just through like the Holy Spirit's voice in my heart, I ended up going to David's tent in July of 2020, shortly after COVID started. So I was really grateful that I got to go, because I didn't know if I'd be able to go because of traveling and everything. And David's tent is a tent on the National Mall, and it's been going 24/7 since 2015. They have 24/7 prayer and worship, and wow, they work with YWAM over there. So I was on staff with other YWAM missionaries, and we live together in houses in Maryland, and then we drive together to D.C., which was about 20 minutes away, every day, usually 6 days a week, for several hours, and we would keep watches at the tent. So it was like open 24/7. And some people we all had different shifts, you know. And I was on day watch for about a year, and then I was on night watch for about a year. And each hour we did so much worship. Like, they always have a live worship leader. We prayed and we read the Bible. And it really brought me closer to God, and I love the people that I worshiped with and that I worked with. And I was trying to think about stories that I wanted to tell, and last night I was having trouble sleeping, and I had all of these great memories from David's tent running through my mind, and I was like, I don't know which ones to share. So I just picked a few. So first, I just want to tell about a few people that came into the tent when I was on night watch, because what was so special about night watch to me was it was so intimate. Like, we always had 3 staff there, so it was me, 2 other staff, and then the Holy Spirit. Mm. And then you'd get a few people on night that would come in as guests, but not very many. So it was very like intimate, and just like you and Jesus and a couple friends. gonna walk into the tent, but I just wanna share. I just wanna share about one guy that walked into the tent that I met named Jesse. The day before, we had a guest speaker come and share with us named Dick Eastman, and he runs Every Home for Christ, and he was talking about how God had shown him his heart of compassion for the lost. And that day I was like, God, I was like, I don't feel like I really have compassion for the lost like I should. And I was like, I was just praying, like, I want your heart. And that was one thing he had said to me before going to Davidson, is that he was going to expand my heart and show me more of his heart in the United States. And after Jake's maturity, I was like, I want to experience your heart like he did. Like, I want your passion, especially for people that come into the tent, because some of the ones who come in there are born again and they come in and are touched by the Holy Spirit, but some of them aren't. Some of them come in there and are on drugs, you know, and some of them, especially like if they're homeless, some of them aren't in their right mind, and some of them come in and they're like, what is this place? And we get to share with them the gospel. So that the next day after I was praying, God, I really want your heart for people, this guy came into the tent who I think he was homeless, and I was able to talk with him, and I wasn't planning on talking with him, but somehow we got in a conversation, and I asked him his name, and he said his name was Jesse. And I just started like asking him if he knew the Lord, and I started sharing the gospel with him. And in my heart, I just felt like this longing, like God wants him in the family. And I was saying like God wants to be your father, and he wants to adopt you as his son. And my heart was like, in my heart, I just felt like, God, like you want to save this guy. And I asked him if he wanted to give his life to Jesus, and he said, no, I'm not ready. And I was like, okay. So I didn't push it on him, you know, but I just said, okay, I'll pray for you. And afterwards, I asked my friends to pray with me for him. But I felt like that was like, just like a little piece of God's heart, because I was just feeling like this longing, like, God, save these people who come into the tent, you know, like, and some of them, they don't know that they need Jesus. Some of them are hungry, and some of them, they just come in just to get out of the rain or something, but it's like they all need Jesus.
Amen.
So I felt like God started giving me just like more love for people when I was there. There was another story I wanted to share. Was there was a guy who came in when I was there with my friends Michelle and Rachel, and we were just sitting in a circle and praying and worshiping, and honestly also kind of goofing off, because sometimes we would get distracted and then we would just tell funny stories and be like, okay, we need to pray now. So it was kind of that kind of night. This guy came into the tent and he was asking for directions because he had to get to a certain street, and my friend Michelle was like, that street is really far away and it's going to take you a long time to get there, so why don't you just wait here until the end of our watch? I think we had 1 or 2 hours left, and I'll take you in my car at the end. And so he said, okay. And she started talking to him and sharing the gospel, and we just felt like the anointing just come on us just in this conversation. And I wish I could remember everything she shared, but she basically shared the gospel and was telling him how much, like, how able God was to save him. And he told her that he sometimes cut himself, and he, like, struggled emotionally with different things. And she was saying, God can deliver you of that, and he wants to save you. And she shared the gospel, and she said, do you want to get saved tonight? And he was like, yes, I do. And so she ended up praying the salvation prayer with him and getting his contact info. And she's like, we're going to do a Bible study together. And it was so encouraging, you know, to see somebody just come in and like our focus when we're there is like, we just want to worship you, Jesus. Like, our heart is to minister to you, to bring this love offering. But then people come in and the Holy Spirit's in there and they encounter the Holy Spirit. Sometimes you get to be a part of it. So it really, it was it was really encouraging for me. Another thing I'm gonna share is from January 6th, 2021. That was that day that they had the, you know, that whole uproar. And the tent had just moved to a spot. We're normally at this one spot in the middle of the mall, but for a few weeks we were in a spot that was closer to the Capitol, and they were having a Trump rally. And a lot of the people that came for the Trump rally were Christians, which we didn't really know what to expect for this day. We knew it would be crazy, like some of the roads had blocked out. But so many of the believers that came from the Trump rally came into the tent and started worshiping. And I just remember that day was just like packed. And it was like there was revival in the tent. And it was just like glorious. And we were singing. And I remember one song was saying, "Jesus, we're not here for Biden and we're not here for Trump. We're just here to lift your name up higher." And it was like you could feel people's hearts was like just longing to praise Jesus, and that it was all about him. And it was really glorious. And so that was January 2021, and we were worshiping. I felt like God was showing me, he was saying, "I want to move in the United States." And I felt more of desire, like, to see revival in the U.S. and to see the Holy Spirit come in the U.S. And so it's like I knew he was saying, for now, stay in the U.S. because I'm showing you more of my heart for this country.
Amen. Amen.
So I kept praying. I kept staying and I prayed. And my friends were, they loved God a lot. And their hearts were also for Washington, D.C. and for the U.S. And so they, like, inspired me. And so that whole year, we just prayed and we worshiped and we spent time as a community together. And then that was January 2021. In February of 2022, Dick Eastman came again to share with us. And he did a school that was about a few days, 4 or 5 days maybe. And he was talking about prayer. And he said, he was just talking about how the power of prayer and how it can change the world. And I remember one day when he was talking about prayer, the Holy Spirit started talking to my heart, and he said, "Ask me for the nations." And so I just started praying for the nations more. And I felt like God started, I still had a heart for the U.S. I was still praying like for our president and D.C. and this country. But God started shifting my focus more to the nations, like at the beginning of last year. And I felt like he was preparing my heart for more the international side, which is something that I kind of put on the back burner while I was in David's tent. And because he showed me I love the U.S. and I love the world, and you know, he wants us to know his heart for this country and for other countries as well. And so as I was asking him for the nations, he also put it on my heart to do a Frontiers Mission School. And I knew that was coming at some point, but I didn't know when, and I didn't know what it would look like. So I found a mission school with YWAM in Costa Rica, and you would go there for a few months, and then they send you to whatever country God leads you to for several more months. And so I signed up for the school, I got accepted. I was supposed to start in January of this year. But God kind of changed my direction. So as I was praying into the Costa Rica school, one of my prayers was, "God, after I go to Costa Rica, what country do you want to send me to? And especially, like, where do you want me to go long term, and where are you really calling me to?" And the more I prayed, there was this prayer room that is run by David's tent that I sometimes would go to. And they have a globe in there, and I'd pray over the globe. And as I pray over the globe, I felt like God started putting the Middle East on my heart and just the countries in that area. And many times when I was in that prayer room, I felt like my heart was like compelled to pray for the Middle East. I was like, "God, are a lot of Muslims live there, and I know that it's hot. That's about all I knew, you know? And, but I just was like, just sensing that maybe he wanted me to think about going to the Middle East. And then I felt like he said house of prayer. And I felt like he said be plugged into house of prayer when you go there. So in October, so I had that kind of in my mind, and in October of last year, 2022, I switched from night watch, and I was at the tent during the day, and this group came to the tent called Maps Global, and I had never heard of them, but they prayed for Washington, D.C., and they worshipped, and the presence of Jesus in the room was so refreshing. It actually reminded me of being at IHOP.
What did you say that in the
It was called Maps Global. Yeah. And I just loved being in the presence of God. And it was cool because I didn't know anything about this group. But I heard them worship for 2 days. And then the third day, my friend called me. And she didn't know that they were visiting the tent. And my friend said to me on the phone, and she's like, Mary, have you ever heard of Maps Global? And I didn't know at the time it was the same group. And so I was like, no, I haven't heard of them. And she said, well, they're this group, and they have a Frontiers Mission School in Virginia, and they have a house of prayer in Virginia, and they have houses of prayer in the Middle East. And she said they train people up, and then they send them to work in their houses of prayer in the Middle East.
Wow.
I was like, God's been speaking to me about the Middle East and the house of prayer. This is crazy. And then I found out later, they were just at the tent, which I didn't even know that they were. And so I was like, God, are you telling me to go to Maps Global instead of go to Costa Rica with YWAM? Mm. And I was a little bit confused about it, but God showed me that he wanted me to go to Maps Global and prepare to go to the Middle East. And I wasn't going to share this, but I just want to share something that he, like a little vision he gave me in my mind to confirm that I was supposed to go to Maps Global. Because I was saying, God, I thought you said Costa Rica and then the Middle East. But now I'm hearing Maps Global in the Middle East. Which is it? And I saw this picture of like me in front of these rocks that are like islands. And I see this rock way over there, and it's called the Middle East. And God is like, I want you to go to that rock way over there. And I see this bridge right here, and it's the Costa Rica YWAM bridge. And I'm thinking, okay, I'm going to start crossing this bridge in faith. It's going to get me to this rock, which is YWAM Middle East. And then that'll get me to the House of Prayer Middle East. So as I'm crossing the Costa Rica bridge, all of a sudden another bridge comes up. And it's like a direct path to the Middle East island. And God is like, you didn't see this bridge before, but I'm showing it to you now. And this is actually the way I want you to go.
Wow.
So that really like encouraged me, and it was confirmation. Mm-hmm. You know? So I ended up signing up for the Maps Global School. And I was going to start that in August of this year. And he's having me now. I mean, I was going to start it in February, like a few weeks ago of this year. And he's having me wait until August. So that just to say, I thought he was telling me to do this timing. He's saying, no, this is actually the timing. I don't know why he leaves me like that sometimes, but he does. And he's just teaching me how to trust him.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Amen.
So I'm now getting ready to go to the Maps Global School in Virginia in August.
Amen.
And basically it's going to be about 5 or 6 months I'll be in Virginia, and we're going to do classes of foundational teachings from the Word, and along with worship leading training, because I play the keyboard, like that's the same, but I need to learn how to lead worship. And so they're going to have worship leading training, and we're going to be in their house of prayer for a few hours a week, and we're going to take Bible classes. And at the end of the time, the So that's what I'm gonna do. And I wanna invite, well, I wanna give you guys just a little bit of information for anyone who's interested in either David's Tent or Maps Global. The website for David's Tent is davidstentdc.org. And David's Tent has, you can visit David's Tent anytime you want. But they have a thing they do where each week is represented by a different state in the U.S. And so, like one week they'll say anybody who lives in Kansas, come to David's Tent, represent your state, and worship Jesus with us. And then another week they'll be like, everybody who lives in California, come visit us this week. So Arizona week this year is August 6th through 12th. And we're actually going to have a team from my church that I attend, that I usually attend as Church of the Nations, and we're going to have a team from that church. But anybody who wants to come with us, so any of you would like to join with us for Arizona week, that week, we would be happy to have you come. Just talk to me, you know, I can give you more information about it. And that's the beginning of August. And during that week, we're also going to visit the MAPS Global School because it's about a 2-hour drive away from that. They do have a couple MAPS Global open houses coming up. It's in Richmond, Virginia. They have some open houses coming up in May and June. But if you want to go to the tent, you want to go to MAPS Global, you can do both in August. If you feel like the Holy Spirit's leading you to, David's Tent more is focused on praying for the U.S. and Washington, D.C. Maps Global is focused on praying for Virginia and the Middle East. So,
thank God.
Whatever God's